The Amazon Synod, having brought the spirit of paganism into the heart of the Church and into the Holy Mass, is a total betrayal of the essence of Christ's Gospel and of Christianity as a whole. The Church of Christ is being secretly but officially converted to an anti-church of the New Age. However, this moment of the supreme crime and betrayal requires destruction. And that is why chaos has been created around the issue of the abolition of celibacy. It is intended to stop beforehand God's call for true repentance and restoration of the Church. The very prophets called for repentance, mainly in relation to the First Commandment for the sins of idolatry. They described the sin of idolatry as spiritual fornication, and God punished the people for this sin with wars and Babylonian captivity.
What are the roots of the spirit of lies and heresy, which now has power over the Church and is concentrated in Bergoglio and his team?
The roots trace back through the syncretistic meeting with pagans in Assisi in 1986. To the Second Vatican Council, and are connected to the heretical currents of Neomodernism in the 20th century, Modernism at the turn of the 19th century, and the Enlightenment at the turn of the 18th century. Pope St Pius X attempted to stop this heretical current, which entered into the heart of the Church, in his encyclical Pascendi Dominici Gregis. His motto was to restore all things in Christ. At that time, the Church of God was restored partly by the devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus and the first Fridays connected with penance, and partly by the devotion to Christ the King, especially in Mexico. Many remained faithful to Christ, even at the cost of martyrdom at the time, the year 1929. In 1911, the name of Professor Angelo Roncalli, the future Pope John XXIII, was also placed on the index along with the names of the heretical modernists. After the death of Pius X, the Church's restoration slowly decreased in strength. The poisoned current of modernism began to progress in secret. Under Pius XI, Roncalli was sent de facto as a punishment, as apostolic visitator to Bulgaria and then to Turkey. Later, however, the wind changed, and the latent heretic Roncalli became Pope John XXIII. The cardinal seemed to be paralyzed and unable to respect the fact that according to the dogmatic bull of Paul IV, the one who was a heretic in the past can hold no office in the Church anymore. Even if a heretic was elected pope by unanimous assent, the election would be null and void. All actions of a heretic are without force, the bull states. The spirit of apostasy, which came to power with the election of John XXIII, used the opportunity, and the council was convened under the slogan of aggiornamento, confirming to the world that is the opposite of repentance. The spirit of the world was embraced into the heart of the Church. And the Holy Spirit was gradually expelled. The apostate Bergoglio now brings the poison fruits to ripeness through the Amazon Synod. The council was obliged to address the topical issue, namely to identify and condemn the revived heresies of modernism. The council neglected to do this essential thing, and by its silence, it de facto enabled an invasion by the heretical current. And this is a crime. The heretical stream represented by the Protestant bultmen entered the Catholic Church. John XXIII appointed liberal theologians as moderators of the council. Thanks to a still healthy atmosphere in the Catholic Church at the time, the council could not put into practice things that Bergoglio is now doing. Nevertheless, the council built the pillars for mass apostasy and decay of the Church proceeding in stages. Therefore, it is ridiculous to appeal to the authority of the Second Vatican Council against Bergoglio's heretical activity. Bergoglio considers himself a true interpreter and implementer of the Second Vatican Council, and he truly is one. The fact that the Council contained some Orthodox documents changes nothing about its apostate spirit and heretical agenda. This is evidenced in particular by the decrees Nostra Aetate, Dignitatis Humanae, and others. The Council's ambiguous terms and silence opened the door to the heretical current of Neomodernism. The spirit of heresy penetrated into theological schools, and the fundamental truths of faith began to be denied. In addition, with the adoption of Nostra Aetate, the Council caused a new spirit, the spirit of paganism, to fill the vacuum of disbelief and doubt. Now, according to the Amazon model, we should bow down to idols, demons, and the devil himself, instead of to the true God. If the Church is to see a true restoration and reform, the Second Vatican Council must be declared to be what it really was, a heretical council. The three so-called saint popes, namely John XXIII, Paul VI, and John Paul II, must be posthumously declared heretics and officially excommunicated from the Church. Their canonization is null and void, also because it was decreed by a manifest heretic and apostate Bergoglio.
What are the arguments for the excommunication of the three popes from the Church?
John XXIII programmed a process of reversal within the Church under the slogan of aggiornamento, conforming to the world. He did not do what he was obliged to do, namely to oppose the heresies of Neomodernism. Pope Honorius was guilty in a similar manner when he was silent on the heresy of monothelitism, for which reason he was posthumously excommunicated from the Church. The 1960s saw an invasion of occultism and paganism. Hinduism spread through yoga, Buddhism through oriental philosophies, meditations, and martial arts. This current of neo-paganism swept along masses of disoriented Christians and misled them onto the path of false spirituality. John XXIII did not respond to it in any way. This is a crime. Moreover, through the spirit of aggiornamento, he opened the door of the Church to these poisonous streams. John XXIII refused to reveal the third secret of Fatima, which concerned the internal decay of the Church, which he himself started. Paul VI abused the papal authority to manipulate and consequently approve the Council's final documents. The documents contained both manifest and hidden heresies encoded in ambiguous statements. He thus committed a crime against Christ and the Church. During his pontificate, he was obliged to counteract the spreading heresies of neo-modernism and syncretism with paganism. He did not do so. That was another crime. Today we reap the fruits. Paul VI promoted immoral prelates to key positions and covered up moral offenses. He cannot even be excused by his encyclical defending priestly celibacy or the encyclical Humanae Vitae condemning contraception. In 1983, John Paul II promulgated a new code of canon law by which Freemasons were de facto admitted into the Church and to key positions in the Church. He convened a syncretistic meeting with pagan leaders in Assisi in 1986. He thus made a gesture implying that the pagan paths of the devil worship are equally valid as the path of salvation which Jesus Christ, the Son of God, obtained for us on the cross. This is an extremely grave crime. He thus also set a precedent to the whole Church for legalizing syncretism with paganism and destroying true mission. Through the meeting in Assisi, he embodied the heresy contained in the Second Vatican Council's document Nostra Aetate. He did not stand against the massive spread of neo-modernist heresies contained in the historical critical method. This method denies all miracles contained in Scripture, the divine inspiration of Scripture, the divinity of Christ, His redemptive sacrifice on the cross for our sins, as well as His historical and real resurrection. If during His papacy He was silent on these heresies destroying the Church, He has a terrible responsibility for their deadly fruits. He was obliged to defend faith and morals. Apart from that, John Paul II not only covered up the crimes of homosexual pedophilia, but even issued a secret document which prohibited bishops from radically and openly speaking out against them, as reported by the Polish mass media.
Do 2001 roku, i o tym się nie mówi, powszechnie obowiązywała inny dokument w kościele na temat pedofilii i nazywał się Crimen Solidationis, tak, który był tajną instrukcją instruującą biskupów do trzymania przypadków pedofilii w ukryciu, w tajemnicy. Przecież to obowiązywało do 2001 roku, 20 lat pontyfikatu Jana Pawła II. Czy to nie jest kompromitujące? 20 lat obowiązywała doktryna ukrywania przypadków pedofilii w całym kościele na całym świecie. Od 2001 roku przez kolejne lata pontyfikatu obowiązywała odwrotna doktryna, jakby i papież o wszystkim wiedział, ale nic nie zrobił, albo zrobił bardzo niewiele. Dziesiątki lat zaniedbań. Czy to nie pozwala myśleć o weryfikacji świętości papieża, ponieważ obowiązywał dekret tajny nakazujący ukrywanie tych przypadków?
Today we reap the fruits of his activity. Bergoglio knows that he has a short time, and therefore, in the coming days, he wants to declare the heretical paradigms of the Amazon Synod as well as the abolition of celibacy obligatory. He abuses the papal authority, which, however, no longer belongs to him, since he is a heretic and apostate. In this powerlessness, the Byzantine Catholic Patriarchate, being the voice of prophecy, took a step towards salvation. In an extraordinary election, it proclaimed Archbishop Vigano the rightful Pope. However, the heretic Bergoglio, occupying the papal office, irreversible meteoric steps to destroy the Church. By virtue of false obedience, he tries to draw Catholic bishops into the anti-church of the New Age. Archbishop Vigano is silent on the papal election. He must wait for open support from brave and conscious bishops who will join him and support him as the Pope. Their common goal must be salvation from mass apostasy, which has already been programmed by Bergoglio and is to be announced in the coming days. There is little time left. The faithful need to realize that this determines their salvation and the salvation of their children and grandchildren. The time has come for them to pray for the bishops and to urge them, personally or in writing, to take a decisive step and separate themselves from the invalid Pope. Let them stand up for the new, true Catholic Pope.